Hello everyone, my name is Claus Kropp and I am the manager of the so-called Laurasome Laboratory for Experimental Archaeology. First of all, I want to say thank you to EXARC for this great opportunity to present one aspect of our ongoing research efforts at the Open Air Laboratory as part of the UNESCO World Heritage Site Lorsch Abbey. This paper will be dedicated to medieval agriculture and how we seek to gain new knowledge using experimental archaeology. As part of an introduction, I first want to describe to you what the Open Air Laboratory actually is and what it stands for. Laurasome is a scale 1:1 model of an early medieval manor, including houses, meadows, fields, gardens, as well as livestock and plants. On one hand, it is following a didactic approach to explain manorialism, everyday culture, and crafts of the Carolingian era. On the other hand, it is also a research facility dedicated to experimental archaeological projects, especially to the field of settlement archaeology, indoor climate analysis, as well as agriculture. Please allow me some comments on the livestock as well as plants we use on site, as they are very important for the potential of our research. As for plants, we use old cereal varieties from seed banks, which basically give us an idea of regional varieties still in use until the first half of the 20th century. We also follow the selection of specific traits of plants in order to get closer to medieval appearances. You might ask how that's even possible, but in case of flax, for example, we have some preserved flax bundles allowing us statements about the branching of the stem, for example. As for livestock, we use old heritage breeds again, trying to get as close as possible to the medieval appearances derived from osteological evidence. Having all these animals, meaning sheep, goats, chicken, geese, as well as pigs and cattle, and therefore meaning that we are actually a working farm, this opens up large set of possibilities for practical experiments in that field. The agricultural project with its experimental fields is dedicated to practice a three-field crop rotation system using reconstructed early medieval tillage implements and including old crop varieties as well as the usage of draft cattle. For the scientific approach, a set of parameters was laid out to accompany the agricultural process itself. In this case, a professional weather station is collecting data of rain, wind, and temperature. A set of soil sensors furthermore collects data of soil moisture and temperature from 0 to 90 centimeters in the ground and in different areas of the fields. The soil itself is regularly analyzed and there is a division in manured and non-manured fields. Every cereal is closely monitored throughout the year, including documenting the BBCH scale, height, as well as the yield. Doing so, we were, for example, able to prove in that case of the ridge and furrows. And in the constellation of a dry year, the furrows not only produce higher stems, but also up to double the yield in comparison to the ridges. This has to be seen as a valuable risk minimization strategy of medieval farmers and as part of an even broader system of subsistence strategies. What makes our approach very interesting is the long-term approach we are following. We keep diaries for every field as well as for every crop and document all available data to understand long-term changes, but also climate extremes like the ongoing drought. Every work done in a field is precisely written down, be it what type of implements was used, and in case of the plows, also the furrow depth and width. The long-term monitoring also includes the change of weed seed ecologies on our fields. Twice a year, a biologist is therefore documenting the existing flora on site. This way, we are also able to monitor invasive species, for example. We also plan a long-term monitoring of small rodent populations on the fields, how they influence the harvest, as well as how they were influenced by specific forms of cultivation. In 2021, we will also start, for the first time in this case, with a monitoring project of ground beetles. Embedded in an, as already mentioned, overall three-field crop rotation system, we can divide our agricultural fields in two different systems. A. Ridge and furrows, cultivated using a moldboard plow, and B. Square plots using ARTS. Please note at this point that I do not believe at all that in the course of the Middle Ages the ART was replaced by the moldboard plow. Our practical experience tells us that depending on the soil and task, the usage of an ART can also be necessary on a ridge and furrow, as well as using a moldboard plow and the square plots. A more detailed insight on these questions concerning plowing technology will follow later during this talk. Please allow me yet another side note at this point. As a result of the global drought of 2018, we had to face the situation that plowing up until November was nearly impossible, and after a very small window of good conditions, it was already too wet again to do so. We then decided to use our pigs to do the job and were surprised how well they could function as an efficient substitute for plowing. By now, we use them on a regular basis within our now widened agricultural cycle. We also started a series of experiments whether the bioturbation of the pigs might have played a role in the distribution matrix of ceramics within black soil layers in medieval urban contexts. Let's now have a look at the plow reconstructions we use at the open air laboratory and also how we get from an archaeological find to the final reconstruction. In general, it has to be stated that in 99% of the cases, we will only be able to create ideal models of different plow types rather than being able to reconstruct that one plow we may have found a plowshare of somewhere. Between 2014 and 2020, we constructed a series of 7 different plows and arts, all of which are characterized by different construction details. Taking the reconstruction of our latest art model as an example, we in this case started off with an intense research of plowshare finds in early medieval Ireland, and then decided on a construction which suits the share, in this case proposing a soleless construction. It was followed by the production of the share using Irish bog ore, which was smelted at UCD Dublin, our EXARC twinning partner in this project, and then further processed and blacksmithed at the open air lab. After the initial construction phase, it took us a series of practical tests to find out if some decisions made were adequate or turned out to be inefficient. This light art, which was directly attached to the yoke of the team of draft cattle, was then finally used to a series of draft measurements, which brings me to my next slide. As I already told you, we use draft cattle on site to do all their cultural tasks. As part of the scientific monitoring, we did several series of draft measurements using a professional draft scale, which was allowing us live data analysis and to collect up to 20 measurements per second. With this data, we were both able to determine the average and maximum draft power required in the constellation it was used in. Let me now come to some of the results of these draft measurements in regards of the different plow and ART models we use at the OpenL laboratory. If you look at that slide, you see the results of one particular soil type and field condition we conducted our tests on. The following data can therefore only be representative for those exact conditions. In the course of the last years, we conducted these kind of experiments on a series of different soils, weather and field conditions, both inside and outside the open air laboratory, and therefore were able to create a matrix of different draft requirements. Let's get back to this particular case study. As you can see, there is an increase of draft requirements from ART to moldboard plow, as expected. What do these numbers exactly mean when it comes to the draft cattle used for these tasks? Let's take one of our draft cows for a case study here. Her body weight during the tests was about 400 kilograms. It is known that draft animals can pull up to 10 to 15% of its body weight for a longer amount of time. Knowing that plowing is a task which requires continued draft, we can also state that the light ART on one hand fits quite well in the performance spectrum of that cow, meaning she would also be able to pull it alone. The heavy moldboard plow on the other hand would need up to 4 animals in order to not overload the individual cows. This sheds an interesting light on how we can calculate the involved workforce when it comes to agricultural labors in the early Middle Ages. To close my paper, let me allow 2 more additional remarks on that relation of draft requirements and tillage implements. Firstly, and this is something which needs to be researched for every individual region, in order to apply this data sets to archaeological sites or contexts, it is of course necessary to first evaluate the appearance of the cattle represented there, including possible body weight reconstructions. Secondly, although this graph at first seems straightforward, the complexity of the construction of the ART or plow has a strong influence on the draft requirements. Our heaviest ART, therefore, scores with an average of 140 kilograms, almost as high as the depicted moldboard plow here. Okay, this brings me to a conclusion. I hope to have shown you the potential which lies in our approach to research medieval agriculture at the Open Air Laboratory Laurasome. Solid research results will of course only be possible in a long-term perspective, as changes concerning nutritioning of the soil, arable wheat seeds, among other aspects, just need time. Please understand the Open Air Lab as playground for fellow researchers, and I would very much like to develop new cooperations and joint research projects in the field of agriculture together with you. Thank you for your attention.